When John and Richard discovered NLP, they came up with something called as the Milton model. Now, Milton was a hypnotist, and he was the kind of hypnotist who didn't use a pendulum. People would go to him with different problems, you know, like I can't sleep, or I want to win the gold medal in this competition. And Milton would tell stories. And he wouldn't even tell you, I'm going to tell you a story. You finish telling your problem, and he would say, there was a boy. Milton actually was, you know, he was polio struck when he was 8 years old, and he was paralyzed, and he had an extraordinary life himself, in the sense that he converted all of his weaknesses into strength by, you know, because he was polio struck. In fact, doctors told his mother that he was going to die, and there's no way he will live. He survived that. And because he was polio struck and he was paralyzed, his parents would take him and put him into the farm where the sisters were playing. And he has nothing to do but just watch his sisters play. And he said he learned to recognize when a sister is saying yes to the other, but meaning no. And when the sister is saying no, but meaning yes. And that is when he learned to become a hypnotist. And Milton was also very good, and Milton was tone deaf. He discovered that because he went to a church one day because he heard a lot of people talking at the same time, and he found out, why are they talking at the same time? And he goes to a church and he sees a choir singing. And since he's tone deaf, he doesn't understand that they're singing. He thinks that they're talking at the same time. But then he sees that they're all extremely happy. So he thinks, maybe when people move at the same time, and breathe at the same time, in the same way, they all are going to be happy. And that's how he started experimenting with unconscious rapu. He started noticing what happens if you breathe in the same way the other person is breathing. And he was also very, very self-aware, in the sense, he was, you know, when he was polio struck, he couldn't walk. So he was sitting in this chair that was placed next to a window. And then he sees out of this window and he sees this young, it was a beautiful day, there was flowers on the road and the colors were just vibrant. The temperature was just pleasant. And he sees the voices of cheerful children giggling and walking in the street. And he wishes in his heart, I wish I can just walk on that street. And then he's sitting in this rocking chair and it begins to rock. So Milton thinks, how did the chair rock? It must have been something I did. So he looks at the street again and repeats the same thought, and the chair rocks. And then again, Milton thinks, how did that happen? What did I do physically that got the chair to rock? And then he sees again and he recognizes what we now call as micro muscle movements in his legs that were supposedly paralyzed. So he starts training the micro muscle movements. So, you know, when you and I are physically exercising, we are doing macro movements, right? But then he was training like very micro movements. Like if you watched him, you wouldn't even know he's exercising. But he was very, very, very good with observing micro progress. So he was able to notice that the micro muscles that he was training were getting stronger and stronger and stronger, and he kept doing that for 2 years until he was able to fully recover movements in his leg. Yeah. He got so strong he was able to go canoeing, and he became a medical doctor, and polio struck him the second time. And as a medical doctor, he knows that it's impossible for him to walk again, but he uses the same calibration to retrain himself again to be able to walk. You know, when I once worked with Funny Kumar, I wanted to send him to, he was going to the US, so I taught him techniques by which he could help himself. And one of the things he was working with his unconscious was to get some movements in his feet a little bit. He went through this trance induction, he did it, and he opened his eyes and he looked at his feet and he looked very disappointed and he said, it's not moving. And so what I did is I turned off the light and I took a flashlight and I bounced the light off his feet so that there was a shadow that was formed on the wall, and the shadow was exaggerated. And then he looks at it and he says, the feet is moving. The interesting thing is, I turned off the flashlight, I turned on the light. And then his mother came in and she was like, what are you both looking at? And he's like, don't you see? So Milton was able to train himself to walk again, and he was very good, and someone would come to him. But he had some flaws, like his voice was not well developed because he had he was tone deaf, and also his teeth were all gone. So if someone comes to him with a problem, he would say, okay, sit down in that chair. You know, there was a boy who once had a father who kept beating him, or whatever story he wants to say. But then, no matter, even with all those limitations, people would listen to Milton and they would go, and then Milton will say, and then when Milton brings them back up, they wouldn't remember a word that he spoke. And he would have spoken for like an hour or two. And the interesting thing is, when they come to meet Milton again, they don't have the problems that they originally approached him for. And he refused to the best of what I know, he refused to teach non-medical doctors what he is doing. And medical doctors thought he was doing a hoax. So it was a very bad place to be in. But he had a set of students who were medical doctors who came and who were listening to what he was doing, because he had like very fine medical journals. Since he's a doctor, he had documented everything that he did. And people who read those journals were fascinated, and they came and wanted to learn from him. Unfortunately, what he thought he did and what he shared with his students didn't necessarily give them the same results. So at the same time, there was a guy called Gregory Bateson, who's an anthropologist. He's an award-winning anthropologist, a very famous one. And Gregory had sent a lot of his students to say, Milton is doing something incredible, the world needs it, go find out what he's doing. And his students, Gregory's students would go, and when they come back, Gregory would ask, so what did Milton do? And they would go, So finally, Gregory finds John and Richard and tells John and Richard, there's Milton Erickson, would you go? And John and Richard had just then started developing this set of tools for modeling on how to learn unconsciously and stuff like that. And Gregory said, would you go and see, find out what Milton is doing? Richard said, yes. John said, no, I'm not going. And John told me now that the reason he denied to go was because he knew all the physical challenges Milton had gone through. And at that point in time, John wasn't sure if he can do unconscious assimilation and learn from Milton without allowing his own health to be affected. And so John took 3 months to test the concept of filters, if he's able to mirror systematically and not be affected by what the other person is emotionally or physically going through. And then after 3 months, he went and told Gregory, now I think we can go. So Richard and John have to make a phone call to Milton, and they have to get an appointment. They're not medical doctors, so it's not easy. But they have Gregory's reference, and Gregory was highly reputed, so it is possible, but they still have to convince Milton to get an appointment. So they call up Milton, so they toss a coin, and whoever it comes on has to make the call, it comes on Richard. So Richard picks up the phone, and then he calls, and Milton says in his voice, hello, and then Richard tries to copy that. He says, hello, and this is Richard. And then he says something like, when can we meet you? Now or in the next week? Now, in neuro-linguistic programming, you call that a presupposition. It's a simple language technique that assumes that you have already decided to, that the other person has already decided to meet you. If you are in unconscious rapport and you make that assumption, then the other person may make that assumption along with you. If you're not in rapport and you make that assumption, the other person will think you're a jerk. So that's why Richard had to very carefully pace Milton over the phone and then ask that question. It's interesting because Milton demonstrates presuppositions differently. He would have a group of medical doctors sitting and he would keep talking for hours and hours and hours. And then he would say, let me demonstrate to you something interesting. And he'll bring three people on stage. He'll put them into what is called as a subluministic trance, which is their eyes are open, but they're in a kind of a different altered state. And then he would look at one corner like that for one whole minute. And he'll say, what is the color of that dog there? And, you know, the people over here would come up with some color. They would be like, that's a brown dog. And when they do that, interestingly, people in the participants would suddenly, some of them would stand up and say, that is not a brown dog, that's a black dog. So, you know, presuppositions, that's an example of presupposition, that if you're in deep enough rapport, that you could actually presuppose something that isn't there, and people would start adding details to what isn't there in the first place. And so that's what Richard did. And then Richard and John went and modeled Milton. So what they did is they would sit and in their head, they would decide that they have become Milton Erickson. And then they would just, you know, observe everything that's going on. At the end of the day, they would call up their team back in California that, hey, today Milton worked on wheezing. Get me 10 people who are volunteers who want to get over wheezing. Right? So they would be with Milton for a month or two, and their team would arrange all the volunteers for them to practice. And then they would go back to California for a month, and they would do exactly what they saw Milton do. According to John, they did this immersively for 8 months. And then what happened was something interesting. They went to Milton and they would see a new client come in. And then as Milton is doing, they intuitively started knowing what Milton is going to be doing next. And then they were able to do clients in the same way that they hadn't seen a demonstration by Milton before. And then they became as good as necessary for them to get the same results as Milton was getting. Now John and Richard said, okay, now that we're able to get the results, let's explore what are the variables that are not necessary. So they said, do we need to talk in this voice? And they started speaking in their own natural voice and they got the same result. So they removed that off the plate. So they started deleting all the things that even after deleting were giving them the same result. And then they compiled something together called the Milton model. And their objective of the Milton model is this. Without direct access to Milton, can someone just train themselves on this model and get similar results as what Milton was getting? Then they believe that they have actually created a successful model. So that's the Milton model. There are some rumors, I don't know if it's true, that once there was a medical committee that was appointed to evaluate whether Milton Erickson should still continue to hold the medical license or not. And they say that apparently the guy who was in charge of making the decision coincidentally happened to be in the same flight as Milton Erickson. And that And that the first thing he said as soon as the conference began is, why are we even evaluating him? He's an excellent doctor. So John and Richard, once they became good at this and they started doing things with people, a lot of people became curious. One of the institute that became curious was an institute that was doing research on psychotherapy in California, and they invited John and Richard to come and do a demonstration. So they were supposed to meet a person called Mike. So John and Richard go in there to meet Mike, and then, you know, the organizers say Mike is a little delayed, but while we are waiting for him, there is a photographer who seems to have lost passion in his career. Could you demonstrate what you're talking about by working with him? And then they bring in the photographer, and Richard has this wicked smile. And then they go and work with the photographer, and then it's 30 minutes, and then they come into the other room. The team is there, and all of them are a little puzzled why Mike is in there, because Mike was supposed to be there in 30 minutes. So Richard grins and he says, Mike will be here in 10 minutes from now. And as he says, Mike comes 10 minutes from then, and Mike happens to be the photographer. So Richard had seen picture of Mike earlier, so he knew. So what happened was, since they were not licensed therapists, they were not legally allowed to take a client from their clinic and give it to Richard and John, so Mike pretended to be the client. But in the context of teaching or helping him discover his passion for photography, Richard had given this embedded command for Mike to go out and explore the nature and enjoy the walk for precisely 10 minutes and come back. And that's what happened. So this is called the Milton model, okay? Now, in the early days, I used to teach Milton model a lot. But then I soon started finding out that if the suggestions that you're giving, so what parents started doing is parents started going and telling, giving embedded suggestions to their children, study Max, learn Max, wake up at 5 o'clock. Now, it worked, but I also felt very sad that they had to give embedded commands to get their children to do these things. I thought the better thing to do is to make the child passionate and fall in love with the subjects that they want to learn. So then I also realized another thing, that a lot of times when you think about closing deals and sales, it's not about getting the person to do what you want them to do, but for a long-term benefit, it's about understanding where they want to head and making sure you're coming up with a win-win for both, right? Because that is more important than temporarily getting that person to agree and accept to what you are offering. Right, that's why you look at so many people who learn conversational hypnosis. You know, they get what they want immediately, but then if you look at their life as a 5-year, 6-year, they're absolute failures. You know, their businesses crash and things go wrong. So I personally think that before you learn to do embedded suggestions of that nature, it's important that you learn how to understand what is going on in a person's mind, what are the things that they're not saying, how are they thinking, and what are the things that you need to know about this person before you learn to just suggest. The way I personally use Milton model is I use it as an accelerator, never as a way to get people to do things. So what do I mean by that? So let's say someone wants to buy something from me. They have not yet decided to buy that from me. There are two ways I can approach this. In my conversation, I can elicit a state where they are suggestible, and you can do that very easily by mirroring, and then you can give them an embedded command that gets them to take the action. That's not the right way to do, because after they buy, they might have buyer's remorse. The other way to do it is you find out what is their motivation strategy. What pictures are they naturally making in their head? And how you could communicate in a way that makes them want to get it for the right reason. Now, after you've done that, they may do that in the same day, they may do that in 10 days, or they make it procrastinated and do after 6 months. But they have decided to buy anyway. So then I use embedded suggestions as an accelerator. So after they have decided, instead of doing it in 6 months, I might probably get them to do it in a week or in the same day. So that is the relationship that I maintain, and I think it's absolutely important. Okay, I'm going to try and teach and share whatever I know about both of these two things to you. But you have to remember that if you think about influencing before understanding, within 5 years, you will lose your friends, you will lose goodwill that you might have, and a lot of bad things might happen. But on the other hand, if you pay attention to shifting their frames, and instead of manipulating them, if you use suggestions as a way to accelerate, then they would love to be influenced by you. You know, the best comments that I get is when people come and tell me, Antano, it's so amazing how you influence me, and I love the fact that you continue to influence me. You know, that's a good place to be in. See, you know, Milton was supposedly the best hypnotist in town, and they say that if he wanted somebody to go climb the mountain and pick 2 flowers for him and come back, he could just use hypnosis so easily that people would do that for him. But every single person I've spoken to, John, Judith, Robert, the people who were there with him, every single person tells you the same thing, that Milton never needed to. And I think that's the best form of influence.